Hello everyone, my name is Bobby Mathew. I'm from the United Arab Emirates University, and this work is presentation we are showing today is a collaborative work with a group of students from Howard University. Let me just get into the topic. So basically what you're doing here is you're trying to come up with a separation device, microfluidic separation device, and there are a lot of applications for microfluidic devices that can separate one type of particle from another type of particle, or one type of based on size based separation or type based separation. So again, basically we are looking at microfluidic devices. You know, it has certain advantages just because it uses a very small size. It has certain advantages, especially when you come to separation and so on. Basically, it allows you to handle really small volumes, and then because of which the reagent volume can be small, and again it has a very high surface area to volume ratio, which allows for these devices to investigate the volume of the fluid much more efficiently. Again, as you all know, you can have different shapes and sizes for these devices, you know, square, rectangular, and so on, depending on the type of fabrication that you do. Again, these are a few examples of devices we have fabricated in the past. So now getting into the main topic, again, as I said, we are looking at separation. So basically, the separation can be of two types. Either you are doing, or basically can be classified into two. Either you are doing a size-based separation where you are having the same size part, same type particle, but then you are trying to separate them based on, you know, separate a smaller particle from a bigger particle, or a bigger particle from a smaller particle. Or you're looking at a type-based separation. For example, you have two types of different particles. Let's assume that they are the same size, and then you're trying to separate, you know, one type of particle from the other type of particle. So type-based separation has a lot of applications in when you're looking at trying to separate two different types of cells and so on. So basically, it has a lot of applications. Anyway, so in terms of if you're trying to achieve separation in microfluidic devices, one of the things is that you need some kind of actuation force so that you can either pull or push one type of particle from the other type of particle, right? So basically there are different types of actuation, non-inversive actuation mechanisms that have been implemented in microfluidic devices, you know, including dielectrophoresis or acoustophoresis, magnetophoresis, and so on. So some of them, you know, each of them has their own advantages and over the other. So basically it depends on the application. Some people prefer one over the other. So one of the issues that's really plaguing separation of microparticles in microfluidic devices is that whenever you introduce a sample into microfluidic devices, they're randomly distributed. So because of this random distribution, whenever these microparticles pass through a investigation zone inside the microfluidic device, we cannot guarantee that each and every microparticle will be exposed to the same actuation force. So unless and until we can guarantee that each and every microparticle is exposed to the same actuation force, we cannot guarantee the repeatability of the device or repeatable performance of the device. So that's one of the issues that always plagues microfluidic devices in terms of separation. And for this, people have come up with the technique called focusing. So you focus, pre-focus microparticles, and then you introduce them into this separation zone. Then you can guarantee that each and every particle is subjected to the same actuation force. So another issue that really plagues microfluidic devices is throughput. So basically, most of the non-inversive actuation forces that we implement in microfluidic devices are short-range forces. So you really cannot have a first of all, they're short-range forces, and then over the distance over which they are acting is also short. So because of which you have to operate this device at a very low flow rate to achieve good performance metrics. So with all that in mind, so basically what we did here is that we came up with we are looking at or trying to implement dielectrophoresis for separation. And again, as you all know, dielectrophoresis uses a few electrical properties to achieve separation. So basically what happens in dielectrophoresis is that whenever you have a neutral particle that passes through a non-uniform electric field, so the particles are either attracted towards the maximum or minimum of the electric field gradient. And based on that, you have two types of dielectrophoresis. One is called the positive DEP, wherein the particles are attracted to the maximum of the electric field, or negative DEP, wherein the particles are attracted to the minimum of the electric field. So depending on the type of particle, you can split them up into two different mixtures if one of them experiences speed up and another one experiences end up, which is what we are trying to achieve in this device. And again, the reason why we adopted or thought of dielectrophoresis for a separation device is because our dielectrophoresis scales well with miniaturization. That means because the electrodes are really close to each other, the electric field that you develop is just inversely proportional to the distance, right? And because of which, since the devices are really small, the distance between the electrodes can be really small, because of which you really just need a very small voltage to get a very high electric field. So then again, one of the things about DEP is that it really depends on the electric field, and it depends also, since it depends on the electric field, it really depends on the electrode configuration, right? Basically, it depends on the type of electrode configuration that you have to achieve the high electric field that you need. So again, there are different types of, people have looked at different types of electrode configurations where you have, I've shown a few of them here. Basically, the first one has all the electrodes on the bottom. So again, they're interdigitated transducer electrodes. You know, one of them is positive, or one of them is given to one polarity, the second one different polarity, and so on. Again, you can have vertical electrodes, you can have planar electrodes, three-dimensional electrodes, you can have electrodes on the top and bottom surface, or you can just have electrodes in the bottom surface. You can have vertical electrodes, horizontal electrodes, and so on. So people have developed all sorts of types of electrodes for microfluidic applications. So the one that going forward, so before we decided on an electrode configuration, what we did is we looked at we wanted to have an electrode configuration that is easy to fabricate, but at the same time generate all the desired DEP forces in the desired directions. And again, one of the things about that separation, if you want to use dielectrophoresis for separation, one of the things is that you have to be able to generate a DEP or a positive DEP as well as a negative DEP at the same time, because of which you can have you can apply them in the horizontal direction and then have separation of two different types of particles, or you can apply them in the vertical direction, you can have the separation that you need. So based on all this, we came up with a configuration of, you know, we used one of the existing or very famous electrode configuration, which is the IDT configuration, or the interdigitated transducer electrode configuration. So what we do in our device is that we have these electrodes or a pair of electrodes, and then we introduce a heterogeneous mixture, randomly distributed mixture of particles into the device, and then basically what happens, some of the green ones get attracted to the electrode because the green ones experience positive DEP, as well as, but the red ones or the orange ones are rippled away from the electrodes because they are experiencing negative DEP. So basically what you can see is that the green ones get attracted onto the electrodes and basically collected at the electrodes, but the red ones are basically rippled, or they levitate inside the medium, and then basically the medium, as the medium is flowing through the device, they can be collected at the exit of the device. So in this way, you can actually have a separation of the two different types of particles. All right, so again, as I said, one of these particles experiences speed up, another one experiences end up, and then what we are trying to look at this, so we have this concept of a device. We just wanted to try to see how this device will behave, and for that, we developed a model, and basically what we did is we looked at two different types of particles. One is a silica particle, other one was a polystyrene microparticle. Each of them have a radius of 3 micrometers. And assuming that we dispersed in some medium with a certain type of conductivity, and we're looking at the Clausius-Mossotti factor. So this is the factor, this is the parameter that determines whether the particle will experience speed up or end up. And we found that the silica particle experiences has lower values of Clausius-Mossotti factor compared to the polystyrene particle. And at about 300 kilohertz, the silica particle experiences end up, while the polystyrene particles experiences PDUP. So with that, we went ahead and did some modeling. So basically, this is the device and this is the particle. Again, we looked at different forces associated with it. And what we did is, again, these are different equations related to the model. So what we did is, we did a finite difference analysis on the finite difference method to solve the model. And what you can see is that this is just where a a simple case, what you have is you have, if you have two different types of particles start originating from the same location, you can see the blue one, which is a silica particle, which experiences end up kind of levitates inside the channel, but the polystyrene particle, which is, has a, which is red in color here, basically is attracted towards the electrode, and basically you can separate these two devices. Again, we went ahead and again, we're looking at trying to understand the performance metrics of these two devices or the device. And we looked at two different parameters. One is the flow rate. And as you can see, the separation efficiency of silica particles keeps remains the same irrespective of the flow rate, because what you need in this device is just to levitate the silica microparticles. But on the other hand, the polystyrene has to be attracted to the electrodes. And then maybe depending on the number of electrode pairs you have, there's not enough time. As you keep increasing the flow rate, there's not enough time for these electrodes to attract the polystyrene to their surface. So because of which the separation efficiency for polystyrene reduces. On the other hand, when the separation efficiency of polystyrene reduces, that means they're showing up at the outlet of the silica particles, because of which as you keep increasing the flow rate, the separation purity of silica particle drops. So basically this is kind of one contradicts the other. So similarly, we looked at different voltages. Again, they showed kind of opposing behavior. For silica particles, as you can see, since they just need to be levitated inside the micro channel, they have very good separation efficiency irrespective of their voltage. And again, on the other hand, the polystyrene particles increase their efficiency as you keep increasing the voltage, because higher the voltage, greater the attractive power. So they're basically attracted towards the electrode faster. On the other hand, the separation purity, of course, remains almost constant for polystyrene particles, but on the other hand, the separation purity for silica particle drop starts slow, but then increases as you keep going. Again, all this can be explained back to the capture of polystyrene particles inside the microchannel. So we looked at a few different parameters, and then of course the study is not complete. We are looking forward to doing further studies and doing some kind of experimental validation on this one. So I'd like to thank my university, which is the United Arab Emirates University, and Howard University for their support. Thank you so much.